In fact, Prakash has already opened up the discussion so vibrantly and wonderfully. And I take for granted whatever Prakash has said is something that we all, not in detail, but we are familiar with, the problem, what is called the problem we are familiar with. But I wish to approach this issue from a slightly different angle. I'm not a legal professional, that's why I'm here, I'm not there. I'm not a legal professional, and I teach literature, culture, and something to do with reflection and creativity. These are the issues that I'm interested in. I thought I'll share some of these things and then see how we can collectively think about a common issue. Okay. Now, we know that the world in which we live is something that is made possible by very divergent, very heterogeneous groups of people. Heterogeneous clusters, they cohabit, they live together. We can't count them, how many are there. There are a large number of people. They're all differentiated ensembles. They're not kind of unified groups as such, but they coexist, not just in India, but everywhere in the world. And then they make possible a certain kind of cohabitation, living with along other people, possible by means of some kind of traditions of learning, some cultures of learning, and also they transmit from time to time, generationally, what they have learned to their progeny. Okay, and these learning traditions are important, and then the way you transmit these learning traditions also is important. Two words come up when we begin to think about these communities and what they communicate to subsequent generations. One is that we talk about culture, second is we talk about tradition. What are these terms? These terms are, culture is something, basically to give a kind of, some kind of working idea about culture. Culture is basically the kind of salient practices we render, whatever we do, those are which are significant ones. That is that they have a certain kind of pattern, they continue to repeat in our day-to-day lives. So those are, our culture is formed by the kind of specific practices on the one hand, and also our accounts about these practices. What is it that we say about the activities that we undertake? When we go to a temple, we render certain kind of practices. When we go through a certain kind of rituals, we undertake certain kind of practices. And what are our accounts about these practices? So culture is basically formed by salient practices on the one hand, and the accounts we provide about them. And traditions are those which actually we hand over, we pass on from one generation to another generation. These are not taught in schools. These are something that in our upbringing we share with our progeny, with our kith and kin. These are transmitted like that. So if all cultures do that, cultures pass on their memories by means of actions, by means of accounts about their actions. If that were so, do all cultures share the same memories? Do all cultures have do the same things? Do they have the same kind of accounts about what they do? No, cultures are different. So the crucial challenge that comes to us is that how do we figure out cultural difference? How do we differentiate one culture from the other culture in the kind of activities that the culture do? So we have to examine the way in which culture manifesting in the form of memory, how do cultural memories get transmitted? In other words, the kind of communication media that we use to transmit our memories from the forefathers to our progeny. This becomes a bigger, major issue to think about. What we tend to call, and I would like to kind of narrow down to Indian scenario, which I'm familiar with, and we are talking to largely Indians, though our friends are there who are also involved in talking, grappling with Indian questions, but this will have implications. As if my time permits, I'll show you a research project that a student has done from Udupi area, actually. So what we call Indian culture is also a kind of a large, you know, kind of a macro heterogeneous assemblage composed of distinct kind of what you call biocultural formations. We are born into a particular culture. That's why our birth takes place in a particular culture, and the culture and bio, these are difficult to differentiate, but also difficult to show continuity between biology and culture. There's a difficulty there. But we are all born into certain kind of rituals, we are born into certain kind of practices. The word jati, which is the kind of biocultural formation I'm referring to, jati comes from the root word jan. Jan means to procreate. Jan, janani, as we all know. Jan is something that generates, that procreates, that brings forth something that did not exist. These are what we call Indian culture is composed of countless number of jatis and janjatis. Janjatis are what are subsequently in the 19th century called tribes. These are janjatis like Kones or rather Savaras. These are all janjatis. And the Jati is a biocultural formation, and it's a peculiar kind of biocultural formation. It has this intrinsic tendency to self-divide. Internally, it divides itself and proliferates. It divides itself and proliferates. That's what Jati is. There's nothing called, it is extremely difficult to unify a Jati. Within a particular Jati, those of us who are familiar with sociological readings of Jati, or even some simple understanding of Jati in our day-to-day life, it is difficult to find a referent for the term Jati. When you say somebody is from Jati, within that Jati, there is another Jati ingrained. There are folds within the folds. It is very difficult. I'll give you a quick example. According to the constitution, there's something called scheduled caste community. I'll confine myself to the Telugu speaking states. There are 56 scheduled caste communities. There is one scheduled caste category under which there are 56 Jatis, scheduled caste Jatis. So which one is the one particular scheduled caste community? It's very difficult to point out, find an easy referent for the term Jati in the Indian context. But these Jatis have generated cultural forms. These Jatis have memories. These memories I call Nemo cultures. These are all Nemo cultures. Nemo is memory, which comes from the word manas and from Greek word Nemo. And these memories of Jatis are transmitted generation after generation, from generation one generation to another generation. And they live to a large extent non-inscriptionally. I'll explain the term in the subsequent slides. Non-inscriptionally, they live on the basis of embodying memory and then retaining the memory and articulating the memory and practices by means of the body. These are all internally differentiated. These memories of the cultures are sustained by those people whom we call guardians of memory. There are guardians of memory. Every Jati has a guardian of memory. I'll try to give you some examples if time permits. That every Jati has a guardian of memory. These are the guardians who sustain the memory and transmit across the generations. Well, if you want sources, there is no singular source. In the Indian context, if you want to look for a particular theory about a Jati, you'll be frustrated. There won't be anything that will be available in a single place. Not just for this, but there are many number of terms for which you do not find a singular place where you will find a kind of crystallized thought about a particular term. In other words, to put it technically, those of you who are familiar with some kind of philosophical discussions, this is a non-conceptual culture where concepts are not consolidated, crystallized into unified meanings. So you do not come across one single, definitive definition of something called Jati. You will not come across that. Well, but generally, large number of compositions, Sanskrit compositions, talk about what Jatis are. Chaturtha, Bhedita, Jatir, Brahmana, Karmabhikruta, Karmabhippura, Tattat Sankarya Sankarya, Pratilomanu Lomasha. How do Jatis proliferate? I said that a Jati is a biocultural unit which has this tendency to internally self-divide itself. How does it self-divide? He says that there is Sankarya constantly. There is a certain kind of, if you want to call contamination, if you like, or if you want to call Sankarya, probably many of you would understand, miscegenation, through which Jatis proliferate, new Jatis come into existence, and then they keep on going. The same text, I'm talking about a composition which is from 9th century, roughly 9th century Sanskrit. As a result, what happens is that Jatyanam Chemtu Sampraptam, Jatis are ananta, infinite in number, endless. They have no beginning, there is no end. Sampraptam Tadvaktum Naivashakyate, to talk about that, Tadvaktum, to talk about it, Naivashakyate, Naivashakya, that is not possible. Nobody can talk about Jatis. Neither Manu nor any of these sutrakaras have dared to compose or, do what is stupidly called census in the 19th century, which the British undertook and then got frustrated and gave up in no time. Okay? About 60 years they spent time. These people have worked on it. You will see the wonderful work maybe in the discussion tomorrow. So Jatis are countless. Nobody, no sutrakara, no bhashyakara tried to number the Jatis. But they have created a template. They said that when a certain kind of Jati mingles with or cohabits with another Jati, certain kind of results emerge. These templates are Anuloma and Pratiloma, hypergamy and hypogamy and hypergamy, okay, in the English language if you want to use them. But it is as a result of proliferation, we cannot count how many Jatis are there in the world. But similarly, if Jatis are not countable, the kind of creations Jatis make, the kind of cultural forms that Jatis generate are also uncountable. As a result, the same kind of composition says that vidyanantasya kalasya samkhyatum naiva shakyate. Vidyas, the creations manifest in two forms, two major forms, vidyas and kalas. Vidya is that which is oral or acoustic, that which is presented by means of the mouth. That is vidya, okay? And then kala is something, those who are not capable of listening and speaking, even they can also perform. That is by means of the gesture. By means of gesture, dance, for instance, would be a kala, okay? Chitra would be a certain kind of kala. Sculpture would be a kala. And then there are, we call them chatushashti kala. 64 kalas are there, they say. The lists are given. The lists are never identical. No list is standardized. Classification takes place, but classification never leads to or culminates or gets sublimated into a kind of concept. That's the peculiarity of this. Those of us who are interested in studying in depth the culture and the way the culture functioned, that is that what is done in the culture, the practices of the culture, and the reflections about the practices in the culture need to be paid attention to. When you begin to pay attention to them, you'll begin to see that there's some kind of, most intellectually challenging kind of problems we come across, okay? So even to this day, nobody defines, before 19th century, nobody ever tried to define or categorize jati. None of the texts that are available to us from Manu to contemporary times, that is until the 19th century, we do not come across that. So, but not only this, but what about the practices? The practices are completely determined by or rendered by me. This is very relevant for those students who are especially in the field of law, because this entire tradition of practice, many of you may be knowing this much better than I do. Many of these practices which are at a local level sustained, generated, and then transmitted, these got vitiated in the subsequent period. But what are these practices? It says that Deshasi kula namcha ye dharma prapravartita. That is that every desha, every local, every locale has its own kind of dharma. And that desha dharma is something that has to be sustained. Yeah? Manu has also a very wonderful statement about this. He says that, I'm not sure I have it with me, but let me see whether I can cite this. Something like, well, achara paramo dharma, that many of you might have heard it. That is that the most important dharma, whatever the dharma shastras might say, but the most important dharma is that achara. Achara is generationally transmitted practice is achara. And these acharas are maintained not by any textbook as such. We do not have a codified law, but these are maintained locally by the particular kind of biocultural formation called the jatis. Jatis maintain them. As a result, the point I'm trying to make is that because the jatis are multiple, countless, the kind of cultural forms they generate are also countless, multiple. They are still alive today. From Kashmir to Kanyakumari or from Gujarat to Odisha, you go there and then you will find out that these are still there. They are extant, they are available, they are throbbing. Many of them are throbbing. Same is the case with the kind of issues, what we call problem-solving issues or what we call conflict resolution issues. All these are tackled at the local level on the basis of these practices, okay? Traditionally handed down practices. But then what happens is that if this has been the tradition, this has been the culture that has gone on for a long time, which is the single point I'm making is that if you want to talk about culture in the Indian context, it is only jati-based cultures. Cultures that are available to us are jati-based. This does not mean that they are insulated, that one jati is not connected to another jati. Jatis live in clusters, they cohabit in clusters. As a result of this, there is a kind of mediation between one jati and the other jati. There is a kind of collective transmission of certain kind of things. I can go into micro details about some of these things, but we don't have time at this stage. But what happens to this kind of cultural practice? If culture is what we say and what others say about what we do, for the last 200 years, what has happened in the Indian context, and in many cases, in the case of cultures which have faced colonialism, is that what others say about what we do have become more important. What I mean by the others here is that what outsiders have said about what we do, our practices, and our accounts about our practices, they have gained more prominence. In fact, that's precisely what Prakash was saying, and the research program also tries to point out that a certain kind of understanding of what is called caste, which is not an Indian term at all, which is a Portuguese term. Martin has written wonderfully about this, about the Portuguese influence, why Portuguese had to use this particular term in this particular way. Those of you who read his work, you will be able to see. This is there in the collection that we will be showing tomorrow. Okay, so what others, that is that what Europeans have begun to say about caste have become more prominent today. And they are the only ones that are standing today as the veridical truth about our cultures and our traditions. Colonial education. See, if culture is something that has been generated with these multiple communities, the new education that has been introduced by colonialism is to put the disastrous kind of consequences of colonial education, beneficial ones also may be there. I'm speaking to you in English. That's one benefit, if you like. Okay, but the disastrous long-term consequences are that it actually broke apart the relationship between jati and culture. In the Indian context, there's nothing like culture without jati. If that is the case, that organic relationship between jati and culture has been ripped apart. A certain kind of conception about jati has been generated in terms of caste, and then a certain kind of denigration of something called culture also has happened in the context of Indian in the context of culture that have been dominated by Europe for about 200 years. There's a disjuncture between the way we think. Today in the universities, we are being given certain kind of concepts on the basis of which we work. We try to understand the world on the basis of concepts. In a culture which has not generated concepts, this does not mean it's the weakness of the culture. It has done something else, much more dynamic. Okay, that is something that we have not been able to find out how to think really. That's the biggest challenge that awaits us in the universities today. Okay, in the humanities and social sciences, we work with a certain kind of educational reflective frame that has been generated elsewhere. As a result, what we face today in the universities, every concept that we deal with, concept of being human, concept of art, concept of philosophy, concept of history, aesthetic, take any term, concept of law, concept of politics, every one of these terms has emerged from European reflections about European culture. European understanding of European culture. I've just done a piece on the concept of art. It's a stunning thing. It's kind of bewildering thing to see that for the last 100 years, there are people who have been writing from Ananda Kumar Swami to contemporary times. They have been dealing with the concept of art as if there is a concept of art already exists in India. In fact, you don't find such a concept in the Indian context. There's nothing like that. But they have assimilated this concept for the last 100 years. The latest book which just came out, if you're familiar with the field, art, B.N. Goswami's kind of major work that has come out recently last week, that also deals with this very concept of art. Without knowing, the concept of art emerges from Christian theology. And that is the only concept that is available in the world. But we tend to think that India has generated art, and then we have also the concept of art. So if you take any of the concepts, for example, concept of law, about which some of you may be familiar, from 18th century, late 18th century, the laws and the ways of understanding of law and the traditions of understanding law have been forcefully imposed on the Indian culture, Indian practices. These have been done. You know, many people tend to, even today when this man Patrick Oliver starts talking about law, he says that Vedas are the ordinances. We don't have a concept like ordinance. And then the Dharma Shastras are law codes, he says. These are bizarre terms. They have no meaning in the context of Indian practices if you begin to reflect on them. That is something that we need to think about. We talk about Nyaya Shastra, which means something completely different in our Indian languages. But we think that there's an easy match and translation possible between the concept and the terms that we are using. So every concept that the university works with, not just this university, but humanities and social sciences universities work with, these concepts are derived concepts. And we have not generated the ability to reflect on them and open them up and see to what extent they reflect the experience of those who are receiving these concepts. That is us. What is our experience and what are these concepts trying to do? And we use the concept, we just kind of repeat the concepts as if we are some kind of sophisticated parrots, as it were. We continue to do that. We build careers. We do that. We all do that. Okay? But there is a need to reflect on that. The fracture that has been made by the European, European thinking, which has been shaped by Christianity, a certain kind of Christianity. Christianity is an extraordinary kind of culture, no doubt about this. It has generated certain kind of wonderful thoughts. But at the same time, we need to ask the question, does Christian experience of its culture, does its understanding of its culture, does it become universal? Does every culture think that way? Should every culture think that way? Do all people think alike? these questions come up, and we need to answer. Each one of us is, has to become a researcher, as it were, and begin to inquire, because there are generations that are, that we are going to bring out. New jatis are going to come out. New generations will come out. We need to think about that. The question comes up, where do we think? This has been done for the last 200 years. Should we begin to think about this? We need to ask the question. Does 3,000 years experience matter, has any kind of valence, has any kind of salience, or only 300 years of force? Which one has the salience? I know that 300 years force is much more powerful. I agree, I understand it. But what about 3,000 years of salient practices and ways of living? Do they have anything to say at all? Do we have anything to learn from them at all? If we don't address those questions, they come up through various nooks and corners, through the pores of our body, as it were, and they begin to trouble us. The kind of psychic problems that we continue to face. One of the things that Indian intellectuals, Indian academics develop is cynicism. Utter cynicism. Every generation, even before they began to think about anything, cynicism develops because we are not able to grapple with this problem. All kinds of psychic problems will crop up in the society, and then we would be responsible as teachers and students and parents. We need to confront. Where do we begin this job? Where do we begin to think about this re-engagement with the problem? It seems to me, as a teacher, I would think that we begin from wherever we are. We are usually in the institutions. We are academics. We teach. Our job is to teach. Our job is to train the next generation and share with the next generation what we think as our problems and probably what our solutions are. So I begin from the classroom itself. I have taught, like many of my friends, I have taught in various universities here and elsewhere. I began to notice after a long time, after taking permission to come in and teach in India, Indian classroom is the most challenging classroom. It is the most heterogeneous classroom that one comes across. When you go to the classroom, an outsider might think that, oh, this is a homogeneous classroom because they're all Indians anyway. But if you have patience and if you have the desire to learn something, yeah, when you go there, teacher on this side is not free from learning. Everybody will have to learn, okay? So when you go to the classroom, when you look at the students and pay a little attention to that, then you begin to see that the classroom is a significantly heterogeneous composition. The assemblages of class is a heterogeneous one. Why? Each of the students comes from a different jati. And each jati, very conservatively, minimally speaking, each jati has at least 1,000 years of cultural longevity. It has existed for more than 1,000 years. Think about washerman jati. Ramayana talks about washerman jati. Yeah? Think about many other kind of jatis. Yeah? Each jati has a significance, and our traditional works, literary, what are called Puranas and Itihasa, they have talked about these various jatis. So if that is the kind of composition that you have, this confronting you in the classroom, we have not developed ways of thinking about them. How do you connect ourselves with them? How do you connect ourselves with their experience, which is also our experience? This is something that as teachers and students, while learning the European knowledge, while learning the concepts, but neither, see, today in our, the pathetic situation in which we are caught is that we are neither in a position to think about these concepts and their baggage, the framework from where they come, and nor are we in a position to reflect on the experience from where our students are coming and we ourselves come. That's the predicament that we are caught in. I'm not saying that I have gone to the other side, I've gone to moksha, I've gained moksha. No, we are all caught in the same boat. We are differently located in the same kind of scenario. How do we find out a way out of this kind of scenario is the challenge that awaits us, not mine, but everybody's, and mine too. So this is the classroom composition. And the classroom composition comes with cultural formations, which is another word for jati, biocultural formations. And also each of these formations has cultural forms they have generated. And if time permits, I'll certainly show you the biocultural formation, their cultural forms of this region, Sahyadri region, this student has done as a part of the semester work. And then each of these has a genealogy, as I said, for at least 1,000-year-old genealogy, okay? Well, I'm just giving you a small list of this. What are these jatis I'm talking about? I'm not talking in abstraction. Many of you are familiar with these jatis than I am. In fact, our composition in this room itself is kind of heterogeneous one with multiple jatis. Jatis like Chakiyars, think about Kudiyattam. Kudiyattam has been sustained. It's been made alive, kept alive, and it has been given enormous amount of energies by Chakiyar community in Kerala. Kudiyattam, and then Kurmis, who perform actually chow dance in Purulia and Mayurbhanj, various areas. Can give you many examples, but I don't have time. Dakalis, which are lowest, so-called lowest of the low, the scheduled caste communities from Telugu regions, they have a Purana tradition, they render this Purana. Domes, which are also from Purulia area, but they're also from other places. If you go to the northeast area, Adis to Dhadis, Langas, Lepchas, Meitis, Mandichus, countless number of them. Nobody would like to count them. I think it's foolish to count them. Okay? So we are all located in them. They live in clusters. We need to understand this. Holeyas and Kons and Jangamas, all these we are familiar with these jatis. Probably our own students come from these kind of genealogies. But we have generated a certain kind of screen between our experiences and our ability to learn. As a result of the screen, we feel, as I think Professor was saying, that we inferioritize ourselves. There's a kind of tremendous amount of self-hatred that gets developed. One successful thing colonialism does successfully is to make you feel inferior. And that is something that is still lurking among us. But this generation should not feel that. Nobody should feel that. Why is it we continue to do that? Because our education has been made us to feel that way. We don't have any concepts. Balu asks this question. Balu S.N. Balagangadhara asks this question. If you ask Europe, what has been its achievements in the last 1,000 years? Europe has a long list of achievements to talk about. What about India? What achievements does it have? Then of course everybody will get up and say that India doesn't have any achievements excepting evil practices like sati burning, or rather, oppression, discrimination. These are the only things we talk about. Is it possible for a culture to live for more than 1,000 years doing nothing? That's the question we have to ask. Okay? We need to begin to search. We need to begin to examine what is available with us. So I have a mantra. Not that it works everywhere, but simple one, difficult to practice. The mantra is simply, what do you do with what you have? What do you do with what you have? Suppose you learn that you are born in a family, a Chachiyar family, and then you have seen even before you are born, you have been hearing the Kudiyattam, kind of rhythms, and then the drum beat of Chanda. This is what you have been hearing. And you get up and when you come into the world, you begin to see precisely that. That is there in every pore of your body, every chromosome of your body. So that is what you have. What do you do with that? You're born in a family from, let's say, the so-called Chamar community. There's nothing like Chamar community. There is either Dakali or Mandichu or this or that. Okay, you can give me many more names of that kind. Okay, what do you have? You have this extraordinary way of reciting a Purana, which I don't have, but this kid has. Okay, so that's what you have. What do you do with what you have is the question. You have a language. What do you do with language? With that language, can you chisel an idiom? Can you turn the phrase in a different way? This is what the guardians of memory have done for centuries. That's what is available to us. They kind of risked their bodies. Their body is the only thing that they have, and whatever their body gave them, by means of those bodies, they have been able to generate cultural forms and creativity. They have been able to spread across and sustain it. So these are nemo cultures. I call these are nemo cultural formations. These nemo cultures are memory based cultures. They have a most important kind of primordial communicational media they deal with, speech and gesture. These become the most primordial communicational form. And then these are the techniques by means of which they transmit memory, by means of song, by means of storytelling, by means of dance. The Pardana tradition, which is close by, probably many of you are familiar with, they are nemo cultural communities. Again, they come from diversified, very different kind of, but so-called lower caste communities. But you and I can't perform Pardana. They alone can do that. And they are also, they only have the sort of privilege to do that. Okay? And here, body becomes very crucial. The resources of the body are put to work. And then a new kind of they get generated. What are the ways in which they learn? They learn by means of immense, kind of immersive listening. They listen to it carefully, immersed in it. They reflect on that. And then on the basis of reflection, they begin to generate something new. So this is the technique. Immersive listening and reflection on that, and also recalling that. And on the basis of that, they generate that. Many concrete instances can be given, but we don't have time. A lot of ethnographic information can also be given. They were not the, remember one point I made earlier, on the entire planet, cultural communities sustain themselves by means of memories, that does not mean that every culture has the same memory. cultural difference can be found out by means of the, by means, what are the modes through which particular culture transmits its memory? That's the crucial question, a kind of communication medium, if you like. So here we can say broadly differentiate something called inscriptive culture and non-inscriptive culture. Nemo cultures or memory-based cultures are non-inscriptive, but when memory gets articulated by inscriptional means, by means of writing, by means of recording, by means of kind of typing, any of these inscriptional means, memory is retained externally, external to the body. When memory is retained externally, you get a different kind of cultural reflection, cultural thought. In fact, the entire European thought, some of the major scholars claim this, entire European thought has been transformed by the development of writing. It is law, philosophy, reason, grammar, all these crucial faculties or disciplines have emerged only after writing developed in the European context. This is a major standing argument even to this day as I speak. Okay? But this is completely disproved, totally disproved by the Indian experience. Panini Sastadhyayi, which is about generation of language, which has been composed where writing was not there, and writing is not necessary to teach that. Second thing, reflections on grammar in the Indian context were developed at least 1,000 years before something called writing came into existence. Europe today tells major scholars in Europe, I can give you the names, major scholars in Europe today say that writing is, grammar, study of grammar is impossible without writing. So, it, and then Indian experience tells you that you don't need writing. Okay, you don't need writing to sustain a certain kind of cultural memory and generate certain kind of cultural forms. Many examples can be given. Logic has been developed without turning towards, mathematics has been developed without taking recourse to inscription. So nemocultures, what I call nemocultures, are cultures of memory generated and sustained by biocultural formations, which are jatis. They spread generation after generation, they transmit, they render them, they sustain, and then the memory gets replenished by these means. And these are the guardians of memory. This is just one shot, one example. This is a particular community. I mean, I could spend more time on this, but I don't have. These are in Telugu speaking areas. These are the lowest of the low, quote unquote, lowest of the low. These are called Dakali communities. And these do not do this chamar work. Okay? These people actually do not do any work. They tell the Purana. And they speak, they have a manuscript tradition. They maintain the manuscripts. They write on palm leaves. That is their script. Their Purana is inscribed on that. This man holding a manuscript, palm leaf manuscript, this man is, his name is Katal. I mean, we spent quite a bit of time with him. And then he would tell you number of stories from Puranas and explain you about these things. Okay? I don't have time to talk about this, but if you're interested, I'll certainly be willing to spend time with you. What is, if they have not retained their memories outside the body, these cultures have transmitted their cultural memories by means of the body, and they retain their memories, cultural memories and cultural forms, and articulate them by means of the body. That's why the body becomes a lively archive. These guardians of memory, generate and disperse memory through lively archives. An archive, as we understand, is something that is an example, the primary example of memory retained externally. Memory is kept outside, library, archive, museum. These are all, inscriptive cultures, if you like, inscriptive cultural forms, okay? Whereas the cultures that we are dealing with, these are nemo cultures, okay? They don't need to look at the text in order to recite that, perform it. Jatis learn from the earlier jatis, not only their own jati but elsewhere, and then from other jatis, and then they respond to what they have received. So there's a certain kind of mechanism of learning and creation that takes place here. That's what I call responsive reception. They receive something and respond to it, and as a result generate something. That's why you have countless number of Ramayanas and Mahabharatas in the Indian context. And each one is not like the other one. Each jati owned up a Mahabharata and a Ramayana and transformed it and transmitted it. It becomes the Purana or Itihasa of that particular community. This is the way these lively archives have generated themselves and transmitted. And this has gone, I mean, there's more about this. Through languages, interlingual languages, through languages, mixing and sharing the languages, these kind of cultures have spread. Through sonic dispersals, that is, song cultures have been generated, and then the examples are Ojapalis, which is Assam, Meiteis, Manipur, Mizos, Mizoram, Mukwars, Tamil Nadu. You can give countless number of them, and there's no point in counting them. That's the argument that I've put forward. Again, they have developed visual traditions also. Visual cultures also have been developed by these particular communities. They, same community may not develop, but they depend themselves on another community, which is a part of their cluster, and they develop that, and then they provide performative forms, visual forms. So if you want to talk about these jatis, today our predicament is that we need to talk either in terms of conceptual categories that have been generated by social sciences or humanities. And these, the concept of man that is inherent to social sciences and humanities, the concept of man derives from European understanding of European man. That's the basic, it's a theological conception that is the basis of the understanding of these disciplines. So the concept of anthropos, the concept of human in the humanities derives from European cultural understanding, okay? But that is what is dominating today. As a result, what happens is that when we want to do research on our jatis, we are made to become, kind of field workers as such. You go to the field and then extract information, prepare questionnaires and things like that. That's not the way to do a research, but there's something else that we need to undertake, and we are experimenting on this in our context. So in this particular kind of context, where disciplines and discourses have become dominant, which have come from elsewhere, concept-based discourses, there's a tremendous amount of need. Some of you may have noticed, there's a tremendous amount of need to reorient ourselves. This is an absolutely urgent issue. How do we reorient ourselves to access something called our experience? While these dominating frames are still surrounding us and they are encroaching upon us, they've already encroached upon us, but while living in those kind of frames, what are the ways in which we can begin to reorient ourselves becomes the biggest challenge for both the teacher and the student. What we have done in the Indian context is that we are grappling with this problem. Not that we have a final solution, nobody can have a final solution. What we are trying to do is that to think about remapping, or what we call, we should develop what we call a mnemocultural map of India. That is that if memory cultures are very powerful and Indian culture has generated itself on the basis of memory and bodily articulated memory, then we should be in a position to generate a what we call mnemap, M-N-E-M-E-A-P, mnemap, mnemocultural map. And this is an effort to do that. So what we have tried to do is to identify about 7 constellations. Now, jatis live in clusters. As I said, no jati is a unified category. Jatis cannot be categorized. No jati is a unified category. It is an internally dispersive, it has an internally dispersive mechanism or dynamism. It disperses itself, but they can coexist. So multiple jatis come together. When they coexist, they are called clusters. And multiple of those clusters will form into a constellation. So what is called broadly Indian cultural, terrain has been formed, or fabric has been formed by means of multiple clusters and constellations. And we have identified these roughly. I mean, this is not the final one. You can develop a different kind of route map for yourself. Is about 7 of these kind of constellations. Gandhara dispersals, there are jatis which have come in and then moved out, and then cultures that have come in and then moved out from northwestern India. And these are not invasions and all. I mean, that story doesn't work. This is something else that we are talking about. Buddha and Panchatantra have moved from here to all over South Asia, Central Asia, and up to Europe, okay? So through the Silk Route and through the Spice Route, these have traveled. Gandhara is one. And then on the northwestern side, you have Brahmaputra constellation. Again, whole range of jatis and communities we can talk about there. And then there is Indus. The existing Indian map can be taken up. There we can configure these constellations. Constellations, one of the important things we need to notice is that cultural force and then territorial line are not isomorphic in relationship. You cannot border a culture by means of a territorial categorization. It doesn't work. Cultures trespass, transgress, move beyond these territorial lines. The rigidification of territorial lines has happened more recently in the 19th century. Somebody sat and then drew a map with a pencil or a pen and said that this is your side, this is my side. Culture doesn't abide by that. Language doesn't abide by that. It transgresses. They just give you a quick example. When partition took place, Langas from Jaisalmer area in Rajasthan, western Rajasthan, Langas have relatives on the other side. When they drew the map and then drew a line, There are, on the Pakistan side, there are langas. So langas move across the border and then have overnight party and then singing and dancing and come back coolly. This goes on every time. Okay, but then there is a hue and cry in the Delhi saying that this is border crossing that's taking place. But how can you stop langas? They have been singing for generations, for probably I think centuries, and they continue to do so. So culture cannot be simply mapped on the basis of territorial boundaries, territorial lines. So these are just kind of suggestive lines. These constellations are suggestive. Constellations, as you know the metaphor, they are expansive. They expand also. They contract, they expand, they disappear also. Jatis disappear. Jatis come in, new jatis come into existence, old jatis disappear. Same is the case with cultural forms. So there should be a possibility of configuring this kind of mnemocultural map. And then there are several of them, and it is possible, the moment you give this kind of map, students will be able to identify themselves. Oh, I come from this area. What about me, sir? What about me? I'm here. I'm there. They'll be able to locate themselves. And also, apart from locating, they may not speak to you, but they say that I come from that jati, sir. Okay? There are a large number of confessions after the classes. They will come and then tell me. And some of them have worked on their particular cultural formations and jati cultures, in fact. And then they were very proud. They realized the loss of faith, the loss of the kind of self-denigrating attitude is a very recent one, maybe 2-3 generations. When you talked, when we spent a lot of time talking to those figures that I showed you, the guardians of memory, when you talk to them, they are so proud. They're extraordinary, they have their pride in their culture. They say that this is what we have and we will talk about this. That's what they have, they will talk about it. What's the big deal? What's the point? I'll tell you the story, he'll tell the story. Let him tell his own story. They're talking about the same Ramayana and Balarama Katha and then Krishna Arjuna Yuddha and stories like that. Okay? But they say, we'll talk about this in this way. So let them do it their way and we'll do it our way. There's no conflict. There's no genocide here. There's no hatred here. Only when jati is turned into, whatever modern education and modern sort of legal systems have given is that they have turned the jati impulse into an identitarian impulse. And the identitarian impulse has the tendency to develop hatred and tendency to become genocidal. And that's what we are confronting today. Why do they do that? Identitarianism requires homogeneousness, unicity. It has to unify a particular category in such a way, in a seamless way. As a result, you can do something on the basis of this particular identitarian category. That's the most dangerous thing that's happening. That's why when within the SC community, within the Madiga community in Telangana, you'll begin to see that now every political party is accepting that within SCs there should be further categorization. Because once you call something an SC, a large number of, I said 56 jatis are there. All these jatis become bereft of any kind of advantages. Many of these jatis get actually eroded. They disappear. They don't figure into the picture. As a result, now again, of course, that argument is also coming in the identitarian way. So that's the difference between a jati impulse, which is proliferative, which is self-divisive, but proliferative, but non-genocidal. It does not develop hatred. They live together. There is polemics. There is tension. Not that jatis lived in the Indian context peacefully, but there is no jati war as such. It is very difficult to come across jati war. One jati saying that another jati is worthless jati, that's why it should not live. Every jati tends to think that the other jati is worthless jati. That's a different story, even to this day. They are like that, they will say, okay? But these are polemics. These do not coalesce. These do not get consolidated into hatred, hate speeches. They do not get, you know, consolidated into genocidal impulses. That has never happened. This is the most significant thing that we need to notice. Not to celebrate India as such, but a certain kind of phenomenon, where these kind of multiple unlikely communities, they're not like each other. Unlikely communities cohabit, coexist, but it does not lead to a certain kind of genocidality. You know, that's something that is very fascinating. That's worth reading. If you are interested in further research, if you are interested in something, discovering something and then offering something about our practices and our ways of living, I think that research needs to be done by us. Nobody else do that. There is a lovely saying, easily this can be said in Telugu. I don't know how many of you understand Telugu. I mean, you know Telugu. It simply says, let me translate it. If you want to really see the heaven, you need to die, man, it says. Okay? You can't listen to other people and say that heaven means this and that. You know, you need to see that. In other words, we need to do our hard work. We can't expect somebody else to come in and do our work. And it is our work. Because we are talking about our practices and our modes of living, our reflective traditions. This is what we are talking about. And this is the map, roughly. The existing maps don't help us. Google Map did not help us when we were trying to do that. The project actually involves a lot of digital communication media. And then we are training students to live in this today's world. So we make use of that. But this does not, this map is a compromise. It doesn't work. We need to develop that, a new digital map. We need to, in short, what we are trying to say is that in order to understand the complexity or the challenge that awaits us in thinking about culture, or any culture for that matter, but Indian culture in this particular context, which may have something to say about cohabitation, you know, non-hateful cohabitation in the world, probably this experience, which nowhere in the world has. Maybe I think they had such kind of experience might have existed, but for various historical reasons, these memories have disappeared. Okay, and then these memories are still strong; they're alive in the Indian context. But in an extraordinarily forceful way, identitarian mechanisms are getting become invasively they are entering into our scenario. We need to begin to think what are the ways in which we can overcome them and reorient ourselves in terms of teaching, in terms of research, in terms of actually transmitting something to the next generation. Yeah, from here to there, from there to the other. That's something that we need to think about. Okay? I'm not sure whether I have time. Duncan, do I have a few minutes time? I'll just briefly show you. Sorry? Just one small project. I'll just show some of these things. So, okay, whatever I've said so far, it's very simple. Anybody can do it. What do you do with what you have? That's the mantra. But I do not want to give you the impression that some of you have heard about Plato's work called The Republic. Plato was trying to build a new kind of model of life, model of existence. And then he creates an educational system. And then his interlocutor asks him, Socrates, does it exist anywhere in the world? Has it any place anywhere? Does it exist anywhere? Then he says, it doesn't matter whether it existed or not. It may exist in heaven, doesn't matter. But the fact that we can think about that is important, he says. Okay, I'm not being Socratic here. I'm a little more mundane, and I'll try to show you a project which this student has done. It's a semester's work. This idea is like mapping Nemo culture. Where is it? Work, then I'll show you from this side. I'll have to turn this and hold it and show you. I don't know how many of you can see it. Can you turn on the light, please? This is a project that a student, it's called Mapping Nemo Cultures, as you can see. The wire is not sufficient. You can remove that. Yeah. Sorry? Yeah, that's all right. No, it's not working. Okay, I'm not sure how many you can see. It's a hypermedia project. It's a humanities student, it's not a technology student. And then the one page of description, it shows what the concept is. And then he gives various kind of culture forms in this region, Sahyadri region, and Krishna Kaveri region. And three regions he has picked up from this place. And then identified various kind of culture forms. And then this concept form that describes it. And so he made use of the information that's available on the net, and then gave the pieces, the visual cultures, a sort of culture forms in the domains of image, music, text, performances. These are the four domains from where material is gathered and information about them was given. These are the specific cultural forms associated with particular jatis. These are Tol Baba in Guttu, which is, I think, from Kerala region. And then gives the examples. Okay? There are many of them. The whole website is of that kind. Unfortunately, I won't be able to show this to you. But the point I'm trying to make is that today, living in this world today, in our day-to-day classroom situation, the complex problems that we have been trying to think about, these can be talked and shared with students, and then collectively we can begin to think about these things. So the only question that we have to keep on thinking, as in our Carnatic music, you know, they take a raga and then they go on weaving it in multiple times. So similarly, we need to keep on asking the question, what do we do with what we have? If we have many things, if you think we have many things, and what can we do with these things is the question. We are all endowed with certain things. How do we cultivate these endowments is the biggest challenge. And we need to do this collectively. No single person will be able to do. No Indian culture or no culture has been made possible by one particular person or one particular community. No, that has never happened. It will not happen. It happens by means of sharing through responsive receptions. That happens. Smriti responds to Shruti, and Smriti in turn opens up the floodgates for creativity and other kinds of things, and it mingles with many other kind of cultural formations, and something stunningly different emerges in the Indian scenario. Multiple examples can be given, but the time constraint is there, and then it's inexhaustible but still manageable, something that we need to do collectively, think about it collectively. Thank you for your patience. And then we have developed a whole range of courses, and this is the course catalog. I'll leave a copy with Duncan. You can take a look at it. This is about something like 35 courses in this area that we have been able to develop. Every semester we offer a course, and then this is taught, and students will have to do a project. And that project, we've just done a major project on this ancient text called Katha Sarisagara. There's a website we have generated that is available out there. We have done on Panchatantra, that's available on the net. So this is something that we can do today, reflecting on the Jati question. And we can do that. Our richness, our whatever, our sources, our endowments are that, our jatis. What can we do with them is the question. It's a burning question, existential question, ethical question, political question, and whatever you want to call them. This is an important question. Thank you.